you are trying for a so like CC license, it is like Lego toys. Lego toys, you have lot of elements, and then you mix them as per your need, or as per this. Say you want to make a crane, you want to make a house, you want to make a car. So you mix those Lego resources. So similarly here also, say if you see a life cycle of a CC by open textbook, so you'll go to raw material and you have arranged in a particular. So this is the first OER license. Now if you want to remix it, then you can just remix the pieces. If you want to add something to the original, that also you can do. If you want to add or subtract some portion, you can reorganize, you can reuse the pieces, all that you can do. It is only the small elements. And as we said, that these small elements are the pieces which can be reorganized as per the requirement. So, if you go further, there are certain evaluation criteria which need to be followed. As by Plock and Vixen, they had given that the OER should be comprehensive, that it should cover all the aspects, like it should be complete, a whole. Then content accuracy, of course, there's no doubt that the content should be accurate. Then the relevance on the longevity of the OER. That is, say if I want to take an like OER which was made in 2004 on artificial intelligence, there are so many researches which have been done and so much of knowledge which has been changed and updated. So a module in 2004 of artificial intelligence will not be as valid as today. But there are certain, as saying, on history, so those modules will be valid. So what is the relevance, what is the longevity, clarity of the OER, then consistency, the flow, the language, the treatment, modularity. If the resource is on small modules, then of course it is easy for the learner to learn from that. Then the organization structure and the flow of OER should be easy. It should be good. Then interface should be easy for learners. Grammatical errors is a big no-no, because then it is not very receptive if there are a lot of grammatical errors. Then the cultural relevance of the resource. If it is a very Western resource which is like not so applicable in the Indian cultural context, then people will not really prefer it. So how do we attribute OER? The best way of attributing, or the way of attributing OER, is TASL. That is, you have to give the title of the resource. Say title is Understanding OER, author, whosoever is the author, the name of the author, source, from where did you get that get resource. Say if it's a slide short, a slide share, from which website did you get it, or which repository you got it, and the license. What was the license? CC BY, CC BY SA, or CC BY NCSA, whichever was the license. So it is called as TASL, title, author, source, and license. There's a university called Open Educational OER University, in which you have courses from various universities. You can take credit, and then you can claim those credit on those partner universities. So these are the Asian partners like Ambedkar University, Delhi, Usha Martin University, certain colleges like Marian College, and then many more colleges from the Asia. Then there are certain courses also, free courses. You can just go and search on Open Education Copyright and Open Licensing in the digital world. You can just go and see this resource. There are certain resources, like an image can be resource. So this is an image which is shared by Professor Piley. It is CC BY SA. So you can also make a concept map. So this is a concept map on hypothesis. This can be shared as an OER. So as I said, the OER should be of good quality. They should be for higher education thinking skills, like HOTS, as we say, for analysis, evaluating, creating, applying, rather than simple information and knowledge base. So there are many in open resources category. There are many ICT and digital initiatives by MHRD, presently known as the Ministry of Education. So these you can explore. Like you have SWAYAM, which is basically an acronym from Study Webs of Active Learning for Young Aspiring Minds, which was initiated in 2016, and it is growing and people are recognizing it. UGC is giving a recognition. There's a policy support also. Then you have Swayamprabha. Swayamprabha is, say, everybody doesn't have a good internet. In remote areas, you do not have a good internet connectivity. Then how do the knowledge reach those learners? So there's an initiative by Government of India, the DTH channels. These channels are used for broadcasting the resources. So you just need a DTH set-top box and then a television, and you can get all the resources which are made for the internet-based teaching and learning. They are available on the DTH channels as well. You have EPG Pathshala, where also the resources are of open access and they are for you to use. So here you can just then you have the NDL Library, NDL, National Digital Library of India. There in one place you get lots and lots of resources. Then this is a Vidya Mitra. It's one portal where you will get OERs. If you just go through this, then you get lots of resources which are OER. At the same time, it gives you some space to upload also. So this is called as Vidya Mitra. The resources are basically in online. They are as per the UGC, as per the Swayam, they have to be according to the four quadrant. The first quadrant is the video e-tutorial. The second is the e-content. Third is discussion forum, and the fourth is assessment. So I'll stop here.